certainly one of Stalin's camps. And one of the saddest things that you could see, Trotsky was a very optimistic and a very strong person. He actually said to his wife, "What should I do? Should I kill myself?" He contemplated suicide in the hope maybe Stalin would allow their son to live, but he understood that wasn't possible. That Stalin would kill him anyway, and he had to maintain the position. I said earlier, I'm a very good friend of Stepan Volkov. Perhaps at one stage you might invite Stepan if he comes to London. He's getting on a bit in years. And Trotsky's grandson. I've often been to the Trotsky Museum. I was there a few months ago, in November. But in January of last, I went there January of last year, and for the first time I saw a photograph of Stepan Volkov's father. His father's name was Platon Volkov. A member of the opposition, a Bolshevik. Stepan never knew his father. He had no recollection of his father. His father was arrested in 1927, disappeared. He was also shot. Nothing was known of him. And I saw his photograph for the first time. I've known Stepan for 20 years. You know, that's a separate matter. Stepan's mother, one of Trotsky's daughters. One of them died of tuberculosis in the 1920s. This other daughter, Zinaida, went first of all to Turkey to visit Trotsky, visit her father in Constantinople, but he was in exile. She took Stepan Volkov when he was a child. And she left behind Stepan's sister, who was a baby, with the grandmother. It was Trotsky's first wife. Trotsky was married twice. Stalin arrested, the grandmother. The sister disappeared, and Zinaida, under these conditions, committed suicide in Berlin in 1933. What is tragic, I might add, Volkov actually met his sister. He thought that she was dead. He met her again in the 1980s, but they couldn't speak to each other because he'd forgotten his Russian. She couldn't speak Spanish as well. She died of cancer shortly after. This is a terrible chapter. That not many, I think you'd have to go back to the early Christians to see such a persecution as this. Stalin sent the Trotskyists in Russia, were sent to concentration camps, to Vortuka, where they were eventually shot. They struck, by the way, the Trotskyists in these hell holes, in these concentration camps, were the only ones that maintained their party discipline, maintained disgusting groups like this, discussed the world revolution, and even went on strike to defend their conditions against the jailers, against the brutality of Stalin's prisons. And eventually, because they couldn't be crushed, their spirit couldn't be crushed, Stalin sent an order in 1937, and they were taken in groups of 10 to the frozen tundra, and men, women, and children above the age of 14, and they were shot. And when they marched to their deaths, they sang the International. This is where we come from. This is what genuine Trotskyism is. Trotskyism, really speaking, doesn't exist. Trotskyism is Bolshevism. It's the original Bolshevik Leninist that was struggling against this terrible tyranny, this terrible caricature in Russia. And Trotsky withstood all of this. I've talked to his grandson many times about this, about the situation. A small group of people living in this house, which they said is a fortress. It was a big house, that's all, which they managed to obtain. And it had guards. The guards were fairly useless. They were young American kids. They weren't up to much, frankly. And against this was pitted all of the might of Stalin's Russia, of Stalin's state. Stalin issued an order, this man must be silenced. Stalin was frightened even of one man. You know, all of Trotsky's books and all the papers of the Trotskyists were on Stalin's desk the same day. Very often he got the papers before the Trotskyists got them because of his agents. You know, he read a lot of it. What really must have horrified him is that Trotsky was writing a biography of Stalin, which, by the way, is an excellent book. He didn't finish it. It was on his desk when he was assassinated. But it is a very penetrating study of Stalinism and the way in which the party, the regime degenerated, and so on. So, why did Trotsky say this thing? That I consider the last 10 years, from 1930 to 1940, to be the most important period in my life, when he was completely isolated, he was no longer leading the masses and so on. But the reason is this. First of all, on a human scale, you know, it's very easy to kill a person. There's no great art in that. We're very feeble creatures. The human animal is a very feeble animal. The slightest thing will get rid of any one of us. Now, Stalin tried it. He tried to kill Trotsky twice. Once, was it in May? I think it was, the attack of Siqueiros. Siqueiros was a famous Mexican artist, actually. David Siqueiros, very famous Mexican Stalinist. He organized an attack with machine guns and so on and so forth. They killed the guards and burst into the bridge. It wasn't difficult, despite all the talk about the fortress. They opened fire. This was during the night. Stepan Volkov, my friend, escaped. By a miracle, he was shot in the foot. He was in bed. They sprayed his bed with machine gun fire. But he crouched in the corner, and by some miracle, he wasn't hit. For some reason, they didn't put the lights on. I don't know. Maybe they were frightened, or maybe they didn't want to see the faces of their victims. I don't know. They fired. Then they threw incendiary bombs. They tried the same thing in Trotsky. And again, by a miracle, Trotsky survived. His wife protected him with her body, threw herself on top. They didn't succeed. But of course, as Stefan says, if they hadn't succeeded, they would have tried again and again and again, or dropped a bomb on the house, or poisoned the water supply, or anything. They were determined to eliminate Trotsky. Finally, they succeeded by this agent, Ramon Mercader, who the anniversary is this year, isn't it, Ron? It's the 70th anniversary, isn't it? Not too good on dates. In August, he pretended to be a sympathizer, but insinuated himself into the house and said that he had an article that he wanted Trotsky to read, and Trotsky agreed to do this, and of course he produced an ice pick and smashed Trotsky's head. And Trotsky died shortly afterwards. But you see, what I wanted to say is this. Yes, it's very easy to kill a man or a woman. But you see, what you can't kill is an idea. What we have to consider here is the power of ideas. And the power of the ideas of Marxism is just as great now, or 10 times greater than what it's ever been. It was Trotsky's great contribution that he kept these ideas alive when they were being systematically destroyed and slandered, and when the red banner of the October Revolution was being splattered with blood and muck and dirt, dragged through the dirt. Trotsky maintained the honor of the revolution. He maintained the original ideas of the revolution. He maintained the banner of the revolution. And this was his great achievement. And although Trotsky, the man, was assassinated in August of 1940, 70 years ago, before I was born, let alone yourselves. And yet those ideas, if you read the writings of Trotsky, are very much alive. They retain all of their relevance, their profundity, their brilliance, their beauty, I would say. Just as much now as what they did at that time. That is the true meaning of the movement to which we belong. All of us are destined to perish. Nobody is immortal. Trotsky, by the way, Volkov always said to me, he was indifferent to his fate. He actually wasn't even in favor of taking many measures. He was a bit skeptical, very skeptical about the guards and the guns and the towers and so on. He was skeptical. And he wouldn't allow to interfere with his work schedule. He would continue every day at his desk to write, study world events, to provide leadership to the world working class. He was philosophical about it, because he knew that sooner or later, no matter what measures were taken, they were going to get him anyway. That was clear. But you see, the reason why we have to remember Trotsky, of course we could remember him as a great man, which he was, as a great revolutionary, which he was, as a martyr of the working class, which he was, all of these things, yes, but I don't think Trotsky would want us to think of him in those terms. What is important is not the individual man or woman or what is important is the cause of the working class, the cause of international socialism, and the ideas and theories that are the foundations of this movement. And that was Trotsky's great role, and I'm very proud to say, I joined this movement, I joined the Socialist Appeal, before that the Militant, in 1960, 50 years ago. And I will say this, I am more confident now, and I'm more sure now, of the absolute correctness of Marxism than of what I was at that time. Trotsky said something similar shortly before he died. These are the only ideas that can lead to the emancipation of the working class, and therefore the emancipation of the whole of the human race. And there is no cause more important than that. There is no more cause that is better to dedicate your life to than this cause. That is the inner meaning of the life and the work and the ideas of that great man, that great revolutionary, that great theoretician, that great Marxist, that great martyr of the working class, Leon Trotsky.